Clonmel Junction Arts Festival.
Welcome, Foilte. Thank you for being here with us for Junction 2020 Spoken Word. I trust you have made yourselves comfortable, maybe have a cup of tea or something else. We, a group of writers, share our Clonmel, looking at the town, the river and the nature that inspires us. Last year we sat cheek to jowl in the South Tipperary Arts Centre, sipping elderflower cordial and having tea and lemon drizzle cake. This year, each individual piece was captured outdoors by Colin Everett, production manager, and James Donovan, his wingman, in a week of many weathers. They brought the best out of the weather and the writers. We have been gifted a new type of spoken word in this winged town, with its hinterland of meadows and streams flowing to the shore and all overseen by Slieve na Mann. Joining us this evening is Jane Clark, the daughter of the daughter of C.J. Boland. Jane will lead us off on this evening's journey by reading from her grandfather's work taken from my Clonmel scrapbook. Following Jane in order of appearance will be myself, Eileen Atchison, with memories of river and church. Trasa Nic Dirmada, Oscuelga, Rau Can na Siúra. Mark Roper has two poems for us, River and Otter. Patricia Cantwell's dad loved the River Shore, and she reads Lament for My Father. Teresa Jones takes us on a gentle stroll around Clonmel. Mary O'Gorman rocks The Heron and the Hot Tub, followed by her I Am Horses, I Am Swallows. John Corkin is with us for the first time on the Junction Spoken Word, and his piece is On the Shore. Jennifer Cox will remind us all of Sister Bridie and Loretto Convent, and it's called River Sisters. Walter Dunphy will close the first half when he reads from Dennis A. McCarthy's poem, The River and the Song. And then we will have that musical interlude from The Wood of O with Will McClellan and Breach Phelan. Maui Barrett then opens the second part of our spoken word, sharing her historical knowledge lightly in A Working River, followed by her short poem, Muirdia Shúra, River Nymph. Even Hickey with her gentle poem, In the Twilight Hour. Joe Whelan has been busy in the hills around Clonmel, and he has The Sheep Shearers 2020 for us. Grace Wells, her poem is called simply Otter, Such Graceful Creatures. John Cooney takes us on a morning after the night before ramble titled A River Walk. Rita Joyce shares two elegant poems, Casting and Clear Water. Bernie Condon takes us on a winged journey on the wings of the woodcock. Margaret O'Brien has taken her title for her poem from a Rebecca Solnit quote, The world is blue at its edges and in its depths. Eileen Heenahan brings us from the beginning of the shore to its merging with the ocean in her poem of blessing and gratitude to all that has been before this team and all that will be after, and it's called River Shore. To sing us home, we have Breach Phelan and Will McClellan from the Wood of O with their own original piece, Meadow Song. So please sit back, relax. We trust you enjoy The Boatman's Nature, inspired by the vision of Festival Director Cliona Mar, one of our own homegrown talents, who along with her production team and supportive family is delivering a Junction Festival that is doing something different, it is daring, and it attests to its 2020 vision title. Thank you for joining us for the Spoken Word 2020.
I'm Jane Clare. I'm the granddaughter of C.J. Boland. And I'm standing here opposite the Gashouse Bridge, where there's a plaque to his memory. He was a poet who wrote about Clonmel, the Clonmel of his youth at the turn of the century. And his poems feature in a volume called My Clonmel Scrapbook. Most of his poems are about his early life and about the life of the shore and the boatmen of the shore. And the poem I'm going to read is called The Wreck of the Avondale. Newsflash, accident to a coal lighter. On Saturday afternoon, as two lighters containing cargoes of coal were being towed up the river shore by a team of horses from Carrick to Messrs. Phelan's stores, Clonmel, when passing under Sir Thomas Bridge, the hind boat stemmed against the archway. As a result of the impact, the boat immediately began to leak rapidly. The boatman, observing this, at once severed the rope connecting her with the other boat when she drifted some 400 yards down the river and sank. She happily rests in such a position that traffic can go on the river, uninterrupted, and it will not be difficult to have her removed. She contains about 13 or 14 tons of coal. Clonmel Chronicle, November the 4th, 1903. Come all ye tender-hearted sons of ancient Granuaile, I'll tell yous of the fearful wreck of the lighter Avondale. Unto the gasworks she was bound, with horsepower, sail and pole, when she became a total loss with 13 ton of coal. Upon her deck, bold Captain Britt right manfully did stand. One eye he kept upon the sky, the other on the land. His little son was there as well, his terrier dog likewise, and kindly nature seemed to smile upon their enterprise. From Carrick town they made a start, the morning bright and clear. Securely on the tide they sailed by Poolacherry's weir. Kilsheelan they did navigate, and distant Derrynlaugh. And if the final bridge was passed, all danger would be o'er. Oh, brave Sir Thomas Osborne, you little did suspect, against your bridge the Avondale was fated to be wrecked. The cruel pier in her poor side conveyed a dismal hole, scamandering her precious freight of 13 ton of coal. Her skipper and his little son leapt on the other boat, which, notwithstanding all the shock, continued for to float. They cut away the hawser, and they riz a mournful wail, and looked their last upon the mast of the lovely Avondale. Oh, when, the valiant captain said, will I ever brave the gale upon her equal as a boat with her flowing mutton sail? And will I steer her once again through sunshine, rain, or fog? His little son on this exclaimed, oh, father, where's the dog? The awful truth must be revealed. The dog that was the pride of all the dogs in Carrick town, his master now espied. He called him in a broken voice and gave a tearful hail. Sagaciously, the faithful dog three times he wagged his tail. The terrier with intelligence attained the nearest bank. The Avondale, she settled down, and by the bows she sank. The captain and his little son, his sole and only crew, were smothered in their grief and riz a powerful pillaloo. Now here's a health to Captain Britt, likewise his little boy, and may they sail the Avondale and opulence enjoy, and may the Avondale once more be rendered sound and whole, and safely reach the gasworks with her 13 ton of coal.
Hello, my name is Eileen Atchison, and this is a prose poem that was inspired by Cliona Mara's vision for the Spoken Word 2020 for the Junction Arts Festival this year. And I decided to start on the day I was born in St. Joseph's Hospital, looking down on St. Mary's Church and overseen by the River Shore. And it has a nod to C.J. Boland and his wonderful work and the boatman's nature. I hope you enjoy. Memories of river and church. I slipped from the womb in a room on the hill as St. Mary's church bells intoned, it's a girl. Below the house of the bells a river flowed, past Sandybanks, Turn of Abbey, the island, on under convent old and gashouse bridges. Water made a gush like a final push from the womb over weirs that 60 years later I would navigate by boat. Yesterday I floated past that tall church building, carried by gentle waters of the river Shore, goddess of a rue named you. Mary was included in my list of names, Eileen Mary Teresa. Many Marys have followed and flowed through my life since. 52 years after my birth, I sat in St. Mary's weeping as they carried the lamplighter Mary Cummins's remains in, to the strains of O Mary, we crown thee with blossoms today, Queen of the Angels and Queen of the May. Mary, our local hero, who had drawn magic from the children of her river town onto the white memorial stage. Later, that same day, as bells tolled, I held the dying hand of my mother as we, her three daughters, murmured her last decade of her beloved rosary. Holy Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee at the hour of your death. My mother claimed the Devil's Bit as her first mountain, the Clodagh River as her first river. She died beside another Clodagh, a stream which flows to the Anner onto the shore at the foot of Slievenamon. Rivers run through the web of my life, all flow back to the start with my beloved Shore. The Clodagh, the Anner, the Shore. The Brackfort, the Anner, the Shore. Slievenamon remains my one true mountain love, my homing point, my soul's cry. Yet water flows through my veins. Rivers have sustained me and my people in different ways. In my time now, it is a lifeline of beauty, rest and ease. In the time C.J. Boland writes of, it was work, pull, row, haul, sail, hail the Gwendoline, the Fury, the Avondale. His works recall them all. Perhaps the footsteps of Captain Jack Flower, Joe and Mrs. Nelligan and the pensioner join ghosts of long-gone Cromwell soldiers to haunt the laneway to the old church path. People still play cards, drink, but not from small rotund jars. So much love of the Shore weaved into memory from the pen of Clonmel writers after long labours, creating witty ditties, prayerful poems and poignant prose. Heron, swan, eagle, duck fly before our early morning eyes, calling, calling, calling. They dip, dive, going deep, the call of the winged and the wild. River fish jump to flies close to the surface. In a boat drifting on still calm waters, I call in wonder to my lifelong love. Look, a river trout. Reeds, alder, ash, willow, chestnut, elm weave a boundary to keep the river back or to push the land out. Towpath, now called the Blue Way, sees cyclists, fishermen, runners, walkers, path beaters, strollers, move where once horses pulled boats between Carrick-on-Shore and Clonmel. Hitching posts now abandoned and curved enclaves empty. Only horse manure from Trevor's Riding School, evidence of equine pathway. Boats on water now from the island and the boatmen's clubs. Some solo boats. Old memories slip away, captured only in story, song, photo, prose or poem. For me, a river, named for the goddess Aru, flows beside a church in rare Clonmel. It witnessed my quiet arrival 60 autumns ago. It and its tributaries continue beside me almost shyly since. In the time of COVID, I have dipped toes in its clear streams, kayaked in its tributary the Anner, made my way back to its grace in these strange days. The Shore, like a mother, is just there. Where I go is up to me. She is a boundary, a source, a place on my inner map. I am made of water and memory. She is water. She flows to the sea. I too someday will follow her home. Mother, water, daughter.
On Mishuira. Ishka, 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 Gle, Gyal, Glan, Eran Malach, Gudian Ariga, Trihlaun, Theov, Naman. Ag stala una fuinse sa sléite i mar an éile, ag fáil tapceachta ar an tros mar ní neart go cuir le céile. Le craomhhainecha sroláin is srochana, ag lúba go dtí an áirige, ag bailú níort an tamar fad, go dtí an tinmhar i bord láirige. Áhain áling éhan le bithe ag súlacht úntach is difriúil, a thugann deis do dhaoine snámh ráhiach is siúil. Gníomhaíochtaí de ghachsáis ar fálan is de chách, beg an túr mar chuid lárnach is saol chluain mala go bráth.
Hi, my name is Mark Croper. I'm reading these two poems beside the river at Kilsheelan because this is where the impulse for both poems came from. The great American writer Henry David Thoreau once said that a river town is a winged town. A river town is a winged town. It's a beautiful phrase. And I think it could be said that land beside a river is also winged land. Earlier on this year, I spent a lot of time watching a large flock of hooper swans in river meadows at Tibrotny, just down the river from here, where they spent the winter. And lately, we've been walking up the towpath from Kilsheelan towards Clonmel. And we've been lucky enough both to see and hear a pair of otters. And I also swim in the river here at Kilsheelan. So the first poem is called River. River. If I could learn to dwell in the river, if I could learn in the river to have nothing to do with myself, if I could open a door in the river and be, as I am, a flicker of shadow under the bridge, a swallow dipping to sip, little fish in the shallows, weed on the current, the gravelly bed, the sun folding its gold into the flow. If I could learn to go without saying, in the river, be without knowing. The second poem is called Otter. Otter. Your head above water, wearing a river. You, river's face, its appetite, its muscle. Your spraint crammed with its trinkets. In and out of reeds, eating the scent of everything. Nothing so wet. Coat soaked even when dry. Water on your whiskers always, like love. Uderas, water animal. A name for you from the start of names.
Well, we're here in Mulcahy Park in Clonmel on this rather gloomy and overcast summer's day. But this is really a wonderful facility for the town. And I'm very lucky that I live fairly near to the park and I use it regularly. And it's a very tranquil space, particularly if you come early in the morning. It's really lovely, and the wildlife and the swans and the heron, and it's really beautiful, and it's very calm and meditative. But I suppose if you come later in the day, there's a lot of activities and it can become fairly hectic. But just beyond the park is the main cemetery for the town, St. Patrick's Cemetery. And I'm lucky enough to live beyond that again. So every morning when I get up from my bedroom window, I can see, first of all, the cemetery, then the busy road with all the people like ants, cars going up and down, going to work, and all of a frenzy. And then beyond that, the park. And then beyond that, the mountains that are never changing and at the same time ever changing with the various light. And Both my parents are buried in the cemetery here in Clonmel, and I thought I'd like to read a poem that I've written, and I've dedicated this to my father, and it's called Lament for My Father. What is it about the dead? They won't lie easy. Our hearts tied to them. They rule us from the grave. Now, everything makes me sad. Even the trees make me sad. Branches with tears of frost and empty of birds carry the memory of you. You, with your dark hair in a photograph from 1947, taken on a trip to Killarney, smiling. A late September walk, I was 5 or 6, slipped my hand in yours, saw a cobweb of early frost like a shroud on the last blackberries dead on the bushes. But the grief knot wouldn't hold, the rope unraveled. The years brought only distance. Amidst the drudgery of files and facts and scruples, I was the disorder in your ordered life. Your splendid handwriting, the only concession to extravagance. A splash of spontaneity on the dull page of your life. The only time I kissed you was as you lay in your coffin in the gloom of the undertaker's parlour, your fingers entwined with brown rosary beads that had been blessed by Padre Pio. I kissed your cold cheek. You didn't kiss me back. I always knew you wouldn't. But what will shake the heart if not a kiss? What use grief now for the unplowed field of your life where no bird sang? Yet the heart always turns for home, and somehow I know you will wait.
Around Clonmel. Clonmel, our Vale of Honey, the grey stone arch above the West Gate rises above to welcome festival visitors. A gate here once stopped Cromwell and his army. The bells of St Mary's ring out at 6 p.m. across parish lands, the closed gates of the Quaker Cemetery quietly protect those who have passed. Walk Church Road, where bluebells and crocus over the secret tunnel that led the workhouse poor to end their days in the asylum. On to Marlfield, where St Patrick's Well will soothe your soul with quiet solitude, a balm to our busy lives. Stroll the lake, where ducks and swans will clamour to be first for the bread, or will nip the knuckle if you're too slow to share. Then visit the forgotten places, the hives amongst the purple rhododendron, at Kilnamack, climb the hill to Bagwell's Folly, overlooking the river shore. Drive over to Cannon Hill, walk the Munster Way, to the Holy Year Cross, and on to Long Mountain. If you dare, pass the island homestead. Head on to ghostly Glenarry Village, now just walls and memories, a monument to the past, a green museum, a victim of progress. Turning back, head down, inhale the honeysuckle, dream to the blackbird's song, walk the dappled forest paths, throw stones in Glenarry River, listen to the running water and let your stress dissolve. Explore Carey's Castle, where children play hide and seek in the tower. Drift away to the mournful call of the buzzards, caw of the crows, haunting call of the cuckoo, and see how small things really are when you're way above the honeyed vale.
While walking along what is now called the Blue Way, some years ago I saw that Hotel Manila were constructing an outdoor hot tub, and it was going to be on the banks of the river. And I thought to myself that there's a resident heron usually hanging around the place, And I said, I hope it wasn't in my own mind, I said, I hope it wasn't traumatizing him, the poor creature. But anyway, I think maybe it did. So I decided to write a poem in the voice of the heron. I made him a male heron, and I made him absolutely full of himself. So here we go. The heron and the hot tub. I'm the Brad Pitt of herons. I chill out on the river shore. My pad is outside Carrick, but some days I am lured by the thought of a Clonmel bird who lives near Davis Road. So I tell the wife a long-billed lie about bringing home tasty toads. I put on dark sunglasses, gel my long black plume, flap casually on upstream, such a real cool dude. I stop by the leisure centre, snack on frogs and eels. I'm munching on a tasty trout when I notice rising steam coming from a wooden construction, some type of human nest. People are sitting in it in a state of near undress. Their loud talking and laughing has terrified the fish, though ducks don't seem to be disturbed, but ducks were always thick. Nearby is a certain tree trunk where I meet my babe, Danielle. She sent a message with a finch telling me to fly to hell. The hot tub has traumatized her. I'll miss her cute wingspan. How many more chicks will flit? I must concoct a plan. I'll call a special meeting of herons and other birds near Dunstores on Friday night and confront those human nerds. A real hip biker bird, I'll wear my leather jacket, have lots of beers with the gang, squawk up quite a racket. Then full of booze we'll cross the shore and without any remorse hover just above the tub and let nature take its course. If I was asked what was the holiday of my lifetime, I would say that it was my time in Zimbabwe, where I visited my sister-in-law. She was living there. It was a wonderful country and I loved it, but of course it's not so wonderful now, as I think most people know. On my return, part of me missed it and part of me was glad to be home. And upon looking out the window one day, I thought to myself, I'm a bit like the horses. My daughter has horses. Relaxed, calm, and at ease. And then I saw the swallows, and I said, I'm also a bit like the swallows, and that I'm kind of torn about being home and yet wanting to be back. So I called this poem the unusual title, I Am Horses, I Am Swallows. Content with Powerstown sounds, Princess is a giant pup smothering the last daisies. Sammy Joe snouts grass, raises a lazy face to chew, ignores the train snaking to Rosslare. But the swallows are restless. With a flurry of wing beats, they gather on the wire, anxious for Africa. They long to sit with babblers and sunbirds, flirting their wings on baobab trees.
Hi, my name is John Corcoran, and this is called On the Shore. Kayakers running the fish box, boofing weirs and surfing the foam pile. Teens banging tunes on Shore Island and drinking cans among the ruins. Kids sliding down Lady Blessington's bath. Fishermen casting for salmon and trout. Do you remember the sticky slide in the park and the sheds that stank of piss? Now it's picnic tables, safe play areas and early morning yoga. See the rowing club, the boatman's club, jump from the convent bridge and swim up the green. Watch the dragon boat survivors taking on the river for fun. Our playground, free for everyone. Just take away your rubbish when you're done.
River Sisters. She came down from Devil's Bit, a silver thread running through the tapestry of my life. We crossed her bridge uniform in green and red, our naive youth under crimson blushes. 5 years traversing Bridie's Gasthouse Bridge under the watchful eye of the sisters. Cruci dum, spiro fido. The river turned her gentle gaze from green flashes and illicit kisses. Black of male and red of female went sweaty palm to sweaty palm in the freedom of Dowd's Lane. That heady scent of apples igniting our fires to possibility. The waters could take us anywhere. They brought me back to my soul sister in the end. Now I meander alongside, palm to palm with another, watching my own bourns run.
This is a little poem by Carrick poet Dennis A. McCarthy, who emigrated to the United States when he was 16 years old. And in this poem, he's remembering a song his mother used to sing to him back in the 1870s. The title of the song is The River and the Sun. Long, long ago when I was young, 'twas many a song my mother sung. 'Twas many a strain comes back to me, first heard and loved beside her knee. And one old song of all the rest that stirred or soothed my infant breast was sung to such a plaintive air that set me weeping unaware. Yet, though the teardrops fell, I would not go to rest without the song in which she sang about the river sure that runs so pure to Carrick from Clonmel. Perhaps the song to me was dear because I somehow seemed to hear through all its words and all its tones the river singing o'er the stones. The river singing as it flowed by field and wood and winding road, and oh, that song was always sad, however warm the world and glad, and yet I loved it well, and ever begged to hear the strain that ended with the old refrain, the river sure that runs so pure to Carrick from Clonmel. The town from which the river came to me was more than just a name. My fervent fancy made it grand as any town in fairyland. And in my heart I yearned to trace the stream to that enchanted place, for there methought I'd surely spy the towers that kept the heaven on high, and wonders hard to tell. And there I'd see the river's birth, its waters welling from the earth, the river sure that runs so pure to Carrick from Clonmel. And oft in fancy, drifting down, I came again to my own town. I passed beneath its ancient bridge, I pierced the distant mountain ridge. A leaf upon the corn strong, I floated many a mile along, until by Waterford I passed and reached the shining seas at last, that round old Ireland swell. 'Twas thus I used to dream what time my mother sang that haunting rhyme about the shore that runs so pure to Carrick from Clonmel. The world is wide, the years are long, I've heard since then full many a song, and seen with somewhat wearied eyes full many a river fall and rise. And many a grief my heart has felt, many a new-made grave I've knelt, and dreams of promise once I knew have proved unstable and untrue. Still, whate'er befell, the song that charmed my childish ear, I've always heard and held it dear, the river sure that runs so pure to Carrick from Clonmel.
Hello everyone, we're the Wood of O and this is My Lag and Love. Lovesick Llannon, she liberty. For love is Lord of all. Her father sings a running barge twixt Lavabjog and the Drim, and on the lonely river marge she clears his fire for him. When she was only fairy high, her gentle mother died. But do love keeps memory green upon the lagan side. And often when the beetle's horn hath lulled the eve to sleep, I steal unto her shealing lorn, and through adoring peep, there by the cricket singing stone she spares the barwood fire and hums inside sweet undertone the songs of heart's desire. So
when I was considering, I was writing a piece about the boatmen, and I was researching in place names of the Daisha by Patrick Power, and I came across this mention of the River Shore being named after a goddess of a Daisha king. So I looked into that some more, and I discovered that the first person into Ireland was a woman called Cesare, and she is said to have brought the three mother goddesses into Ireland, Eru, Fiola and Banav, and they settled in a converge of the three sister rivers, and the River Shore is named after Eru. So when I was considering a poem, I just kept thinking about all of the people that were taken by the river, and I felt it was very important that we sort of commemorate those as well. So I'm dedicating this poem to all the people who have been taken by the River Shore, and it's called Murdia Nashura, which is mermaid of the river shore. Muirdia na siúra. Do you steal inland midstream with the tide? Tendrils of dillisk curled in your braids, moonlight iridescent on your caudal fin. Sacred water woman, what is your purpose? Is there a lure of the land that calls the merfolk as the lure of the sea speaks to us mortals? Do you ever step out of your sea clothes to venture on soil, naked, vulnerable, shy, seeking your mate? Do you sing him a lullaby, hypnotise with emerald eyes? Daughter of a Dacia king, is your existence a lonesome one? Who dives to the deep, embracing the lost souls taken by the river? Perhaps that's you, Muirdia na siúra. Maybe that is your purpose.
Hello, my name is Eben Hickey, and the poem I'm about to read to you was inspired by long summer days spent reading underneath a tree by the river. In the Twilight Hour, by Eben Hickey. Sunlight filters through the branches on the tree above you, alights on your face, and upon closing your eyes, the sudden shift in awareness can be overwhelming. The slow and persistent trickle of water lapping against the riverbank infiltrates your mind and transports you elsewhere entirely, to a land where ancient gods ruled and fairies and Vikings existed. Their ghostly flagships sail on a river teeming with life, frightening the otters catching salmon in their paws. As a toad with the bearing of Toad of Toad Hall hops among the rocks that jut up from the river's surface. The river, it is the beginning of nature flourishing. Of long summer days spent picnicking and paddling within its shallow waters, sand underfoot, of a girlhood immersed in the classics, wondering as you sit underneath a tree with its branches reaching out as if to beseech the river to continue its symbiotic relationship with it, if it was the river which inspired Spenser to imagine his fairy queen. For you see that magic happens in the mist which acts as a veil between the worlds. The fairy forts and dotted mushroom cups are where fairies dance and weave their magic in the air. Their touch so light it can only be seen at dusk, when you're entering that dreamlike state between wakefulness and the deepest of sleeps. In the twilight hour, the river is the one constant, for nature and your dreams are forever changing with the seasons, and yet, through it all, a river runs like a conduit through it.
The Sheep Shearers. The morning sun had me removing my own fleece. 22 degrees and it wasn't yet 11 o'clock. The flock were in and we waited on the men from the Nair. Gairi's men rise late, but they'd work all night, the uncle said. They'll be here by dinner time. In Harry's Cross, the table was set for 1 o'clock. So we readied sheds in case of rain, corralled pens and darned wool bags. We tied gates with baling twine and ran cables for shears. I opened 2 new tins of rattle, blood red for the pole, ink blue for the hip, stripes and an American flag. They arrived at the crack of noon, just as the buds were ready. I couldn't tell if it was their breakfast or dinner, but when they finished there was little left for dogs. "We'd better make a start," says Gairi, and 4 machines collectively whirred. Dogs worried sheep and flies annoyed men, but the buzzing of the razors drowned out all her pests. I always struggled with the first yo. She'd waltz me across the pen in some obscure tango. Eventually I'd wrestle her to her rear and sit her up like a teddy bear. Gairi effortlessly pulled her to him, making light of my work. The razor lifted the grey coat of winter, a plough pushing away dirty snow, leaving ivory trails on spent ski slopes. Flecks of crimson betrayed his unsteady hand, a consequence of a break for a couple of large bottles. He called for Dettol as flies shrouded the wound. I felt relief for the sheep as her shorn fleece was tossed in the pile. I rattled her pole and hip, our colours, like a biker's badge of honour, marking our territory. Whalen's yo's at a Harney's cross, I said. Gyri jolted me out of my trance as he called for another sheep. I left one daydream and tangled with another across the pen.
Otter, some things happened that should not have. I made mistakes and was given witness to my worst self. I was left like something a spider leaves, sucked of everything except despair. We founder and must find ways to mend. One foot in front of the other, I walked the riverbank, inland, upstream, letting water flow against my failings. I struck a path through cow parsley and nettle, holding the indigo lamp of bluebells to my damage, moving deeper toward the river's quiet country, further into my personal ruin. Where the two converged, I slumped among the wet weeds, wanting the river to wash right through me, to wipe me clean. And up from the liquid surface rose an otter plunging the water. It dived to somersault, to divide in two and become a mated pair. Black as eels, but halo bright, they circled, swimming me into their carnival, into a wider world. So that I want to say, do not fear your anguish. Despair births miracles. Hope is only waiting for release. Pay attention. The signs gifted are subtle. Small beads for the necklace of faith we must thread for ourselves.
A river walk. Up early on the Sunday morning, after the Saturday night blowout. Nothing for it but the walk. Out, down, and soon onto the main street, with its ever so gentle slopes. A odd car crows in me. Last night's sense of menace is absent. Past the old Mangar building, then down to the narrow street, with its shutters and closed shops, pimpled with the discarded wrappings and cold small samples of fast food outlets. I glance down to the Friary Church, before which two old men stand behind a flimsy table, collecting funds from the First Congregation for some good cause or other. Past the statue of the 98 man, the grim fair bollock, we used to say, lured up from the depths of earth and hoisted onto its pedestal by the traces of old songs. No memorial to Fitzgerald, the High Sheriff in 1798, and his long, long legacy. I turn right and pass the courthouse, a place best avoided, though better to have than the antics of that low sheriff, so heavy with the lash and sore tip. Then, out onto no longer functioning quays, to the fast but not furious flowing water, past cross to the Manchester Martyrs, another monument to action elsewhere. Down under the arch, with the echo of the Gashouse Bridge. The clue, as always, is in the name. Past where once there was a chemical factory, producing millions and billions of pills, packaged and exported to nameless countries. Walking down the old towpath, water not bank high, the true trunk shape of trees leaflessly exposed. On the far side of the river, the back ends of big houses. Our betters once lived there. They, knowing how to live in their fixed way, were able to warrant the respect of our elders. Enthralled to the old colonial regime, they went weak at the knees before blue blood. Drifting down along with the flow of current, fresh air rippling through lungs and head, cleansing last night's debris, yet still stealthily in that zone of selection between the two faraway bridges on either end of town. The zone from where some believe the river plucks one body away each and every year. Such folk nonsense and old wives' tales are not included in any papers of authority. I do not believe in such superstitions, but let me not say one bad word about Eru, that ancient goddess of the shore, just in case. Once, I saw men run in haste by the old bridge, one of whom was to howl by the quayside. Upon his sighting of an upturned figure in the river, that figure was a boy I knew well, knew before he had a detached, concentrated look, before he lay stretched, lifeless, across his father's arms, dripping water on his father's clean, dry clothes, before a little car stopped and drove both away. Looking at the water glide by in the broader channel makes me queasy. Its movement makes it like a living thing, always on the go in a world of its own. It too wants to be set free, to roam on roads where it ought not to be, appearing and disappearing in its different guises, unbothered by its own force. It gushes by, foaming a little, eddying here and there, passing in and around the bushes by its side, touching all surfaces that it meets. The elemental power of the water can pull one to itself, not so much a calling as offering a chance to be engulfed in something that would ferry you into the greater world beyond. By now, the cut ditches are opening onto broad fields. The river moves closer to the hills, and there is far more blue sky to see. Being a little jittery, I take a quick left turn, up a slipway and out onto the main road, heading back into town on the straight and narrow, leaving the river to its seaward flow.
This poem is dedicated to the people in the rowing club, which is just here. You can't quite see it behind me. And it's to the trainers and their coach and the coaches of the young people who've given so freely of their time throughout the years. And one of those young people who benefited from it was my own daughter, Cuiva, who had great years here rowing along this river and competing as well. So this the name of this poem, Clear Water, refers to the distance that the lead boat likes to remain ahead of the nearest competitor. So this is for Cuiva and all the other rowers who have trained and who have rowed here in Clonmel. Clear water for Cuiva. The water opens to her stroke, as if it waited all night long to welcome her easy sweep in perfect rhythm and release. The catch, the drive in common time, four by four, rower by rower, to wish and wash of water music. Blades slice shadows beneath convent bridge and onwards towards sandy banks. She answers the river's call. No hour too early, no sacrifice too great. for skull or quad or eight. May life open for you like this river and let you run the race at your own pace. And if you ever overreach, may you know the grace of easy release. My second poem is called Casting, and it relates to a fisherman I saw in Carrick-on-Shore down by the river there last June. I don't know much about fishing, but it seems a very relaxed activity, at least for the fisherman. And so this poem is Casting. I hear a thwack, a zing, a whirl, as he whips the line into the warmth of morning, suspended for the time it takes a breeze to cradle a swirl of silent seas before they fall, futile to resist the river's call. A fisherman sets mayfly to bait salmon that struggle upstream towards Carrick. Brown trout, he tells me, are 10 a penny. I catch something of his calm countenance as he mulls tobacco, and I watch his pipe smoke stream above the water, casting spells against the current. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Bernie Condon. I live here in Clonmel. I'm reading a poem today in St. Patrick's Well, where my wedding photographs were taken 22 years ago. I wrote this poem on the wing of the woodcock to actually see what it might be like to be on the wing of any bird flying around the valley. So this is my poem, On the Wing of the Woodcock. He emerged out of his dense cover, zigzagging through the woodland trees. The early morning sun twinkled between the leaves like a thousand fairy lights. The beautiful woodcock, favouring the cover of darkness, with his brown and cream plumage and spindly legs of pink, he soared and dipped. He was searching for me. In my dreams, I was searching for him. We found each other when our worlds met, as the sun kissed the night away on a May morning. Step onto my wing, the woodcock said to me. I will bring you to a world of wonder. You will see through my eyes the face of the mountains, the heart of the trees, and the sparkling souls of the river. I will gladly go with you, I replied, for I want to see what you see. So up I perched upon his wing and held on tight as he launched and soared in the dawn's early light. We flew to Bagwell's Folly, where the golden veil was filled with the excited chatter of animals as they awoke to a new day. The dewdrops upon the grass sparkled like jewels as we hovered over the valley. He flew me across to where the Nyre Valley sat nestled among the myths and legends of the Cumarra Mountains. On to Mahon Falls, viewing the miracle of its frothy waters cascading over sandstone cliffs. From there, northeast to Slievenamon, the proud mountain of women. We skimmed the waters of the Anner, where trout rise and salmon leap to touch the leaves of the great oaks, standing like sentries, guarding the ancient grounds. The day was drawing to a close as we flew across to the old bridge. I became a child of the moon as it shone down its bridal radiance, bathing the river shore in liquid silver. We stood and watched as the wise old willows bowed and kissed the wonderful weir. Alas, our journey ended. I thanked the woodcock for showing me a display of nature I never knew existed all around Clún Mella, our Vale of Honey. Goodbye, my sweet companion, he said, and away he flew into the night. A sense of loss veiled o'er me, causing my heart to crack like ice on a frozen pond. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Margaret O'Brien, and I'd like to thank everybody at the Clonmel Junction Festival 2020 for inviting me to be part of this very special project. I'd like to read my poem, The World is Blue at Its Edges and in Its Depths, and the title is a line taken from the writer Rebecca Solnit. The world is blue at its edges and in its depths. In COVID time, the month is June, and by now the names of days escape me. But this morning, the bee knew to start with the blue of the sage flower, to flirt with the tiny, pungent stars of thyme flowers, to take full pleasure deep in the blue bell of the comfrey. While in the watery distance, the first bird to leave the ark, a kingfisher, is caught on camera, perched on a branch low to the shore. On this morning, its azure back and orange breast are a brilliant augur of a Slievenamond sunset, a promise of abundance, of love, of peace. Thank you.
River Shore. Legend has it that Lucifer bit deeply into the mountain, tooth broken, spat it out, becoming the Rock of Cashel, seat of monster kings. I emerge from this mountain depth, dark, damp, spring into life, trickling, coming into light, gathering pace, splashing over stones, silt and sand, widening, surprised, becoming. Moving forward, never still, carving through mountain and rock, moving forward, expanding, current pushing through towns and townlands, Perlis, Holy Cross, Kerr, Clonmel, Carrickonshore, flowing with elegance, beauty, grace. Meeting my sisters, Nor and Barrow, veins in the landscape, our mouths opening into the Celtic Sea between Hookhead and Dunmoist. Inflow, outflow, wave and undertone. I carry memories from the deepest past, Vikings, Celts, Normans, Cromwell, mills and monks, livelihood and life force. I have run red with blood. I have run brown, fast and clear. I have currents, eddies and weirs. Home to trout, salmon, otters and eels, herons stand guard on my banks. Stonetrap song fill the air, damsel and dragonflies, bats circle at dusk. Swans, teals and their young float on my back. Through time I carried lighters and yawls, barges, boatmen and their charge. Later, canoes, kayaks, and rowing teams. In the darkest hours and blackest time, I have received lives so desperate for release, taken them swiftly, aquatic requiem. All one. The holy people, traders, lords, boatmen, rowers, anglers, cyclists, walkers, living by my sides through the ages. One human family. I flow, flow, flow towards the ocean. This river of droplets merging to be one.
Hello again. We'd like to say a special word of thanks to Eileen Atchison and Cliona Maher for inviting us to be part of this lovely event, The Boatmen's Nature. And we're looking forward to the next couple of exciting days of the online Junction Festival. Lots of good stuff coming up.
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to play a song called Meadow Song, which is our recently released single that's available to download on iTunes and Spotify.
But I'll rest here.